What up, you guys? So I want to talk about insecurity, but specifically the type of insecurity that people feel when nobody believes in their dreams. And it seems to be such a common thing that people think that, that they need the emotional backing of their family, their wife, husband, kids, daughter, you know what I mean? Whoever it is, you know, and sometimes friends and family are the first ones to like count you out. And it's just life, you know what I mean? Like, first of all, you got to ask yourself, are you someone that makes a lot of announcements? You know how many people announce that they're about to do something and then it never happens? So now the next announcement that you make, it sounds like every other announcement that you made in the past and you never followed up with that. And people, they might know your work ethic. Maybe you're lazy, you know what I'm saying? Or maybe they just don't see, or maybe they do see. Maybe you showed them everything that you were doing and it just doesn't make sense to them. You know what I mean? Like, your goal in life is not to prove yourself worthy to other people. You're worthy without anyone else believing that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know how I know you're worthy? Because I believe in Jesus, you know, and I really believe Jesus died for every human being in this world. So that alone, to me, proves my worth. You know what I mean? It proves that I'm worth something. Like, you know, like, why would God send his only son to die for a bunch of meaningless people? You know, like, and he died for everybody. So everyone has meaning. So the concept of not feeling worthy because people don't see your worth, that should go out the window if you believe in Jesus, you know what I mean? Like, being an insecure Christian makes no sense if, for those of you that are Christian, you know what I mean? Because, like, God himself thinks very highly of you, you know what I mean? But you're allowing what other people's opinion is to, like, dictate what your worth is. And whether or not the people that you really care about see your worth, then you feel like you have worth. But the moment they start to question your worth, then you question it yourself. It means your character is not grounded in anything. You know what I mean? Like, when you build a house on sand, you know, and a storm comes, it's not laid out in cement. Like, it's not like, you know, the foundation is not strong. So when a storm comes, the house gets swept. That's the same thing that happens when your personality isn't grounded in something strong. When your personality depends on other people being reasonable, being kind, being considerate, being there for you emotionally. You know what I'm saying? Like, does it feel good when people cheer you on? Yes. Like, is it nice when people, like, you show somebody your songs and they like it? Yeah, that's awesome. Is it nice if your own mother, your own father supported you? It would be nice. But the fact that that has the power to destroy you, I want to ask you, how much do you believe it yourself if you need a bunch of people to believe it with you? Because everything I believe, I'm willing to believe it by my damn self without any other human being seeing it the way I see it. Because I don't need you to see it the way I see it. If I believe it, why do I need you to believe it? First of all, I'm on a solo mission. This is not a team effort. Like, nobody's on my team. And because nobody's coming with me, why do I need their belief systems to come with me when this is a solo mission anyways? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, for you solopreneurs, you know what I mean, or whatever business or branding you're trying to do, like, there's things you're trying to grow, you know what I mean? And at first you can start doing it by yourself, depending on what you want to do. I don't know what type of business you're trying to scale. You might get to a point where you actually need employees and stuff, and, you know, you can't handle everything as being a one-man army. I get that. But there's a lot of aspirations that you have that might be a solo journey. For instance, if you're a rapper or if you're a singer, when you're rapping and when you're singing, nobody is on that stage with you. You know what I'm saying? Nobody. It doesn't matter if people are cheering you on or not. Like, you know what I'm saying? You're standing on stage right now and there's a couple thousand people in front of you. You know what I mean? Like, all that matters is, do you believe in yourself? Or are you going to get insecure? Like, man, I wonder if these people in the crowd are judging me. Or I wonder what they have to think about me, what they have to say. You know what I mean? I wonder if I'm going to deliver. You know, I wonder this, I wonder that. You know what I mean? Like, first of all, if you're a rapper, if you're a singer, when you get to the point where there's 2,000, 3,000 people in front of you, the question of whether or not you're good or not, that shouldn't even exist. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, all these people are, like, they came to watch you. You know what I mean? You think 3,000 people would come to a show that they think is going to be garbage? Like, so they like you, you know what I mean? And people just take comments so personal, man. I know this one person who wanted to be a YouTuber, got one damn mean comment, and then questioned whether or not he wanted to be a YouTuber. The things that you stand for, it needs to come to under attack. You know why? You know why it's necessary that people attack your dreams? Because then you're going to see to yourself, what do you really believe? Because when a storm comes for real, your belief system gets exposed. You know what I mean? And then if you really believe what you say you do, then you'll believe it. Even if nobody's with you, you know what I'm saying? Even if the world is against you, that's what it means to really believe something. It means that it doesn't matter that my mom doubts me. It doesn't matter that my dad doubts me, my best friend, whoever the hell is doubting you. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, and I want you to ask yourself, how many things matter because you say that they matter, but they don't actually matter. You know what I'm saying? Because so many things matter only as much as you tell yourself that it does. Because for the more times that you tell yourself something matters, it continues to matter. Such as people talking about you behind your back, right? A lot of you think that matters. A lot of you think that other people have no business talking about you behind your back. But you don't realize how much emotional like energy you're wasting into like counseling these people, getting them in person and being like, yo, I heard you said this. What's that about? How come you can't come to me? And none of that has nothing to do with your destination. None of that has nothing to do with what you want to do before you die. Like, you're going to die soon, man. You want to wait? You want to like bring everybody into a room privately and tell them that they don't have the right to talk about you behind your back? Guess what? As soon as you finish telling them that, guess what they're doing 1 hour later? Talking about you behind your back. They're like, yo, this person had the audacity to think they're going to control me. Like, you know what I mean? And maybe none of what is coming out like behind your back is coming out in front of you. That's okay. Like, people are going to be two-faced. A percentage of people are going to be out of their mind. A percentage of people are going to be unreasonable. For those of you that wonder why the hell do people behave a certain way, let me tell you why. Because people do whatever it is they prefer to be doing, and they have a justification behind their actions. And as long as they have a justification for behaving a certain way, the behavior continues as long as the justification exists. You know what I mean? Why do people troll on the internet? Why do people get on YouTube comments and tell other people to go kill themselves? How can someone make such a mean comment? Because they don't have no damn goals. And when you don't have goals, you have time for mediocrity. You have time to get on YouTube and hate on somebody else. You know what I mean? It's because you're not doing much. You know what I mean? It says a lot about the person commenting, you know? So yeah, man. Anyways, there's just, you know, it's a lot of people wasting energy just replying to posts that are stupid. If you comment on a stupid post, how does that make you a smart person to comment on something that's stupid? If you think that post that you just commented on is retarded, then are you not retarded for commenting on it? You know what I mean? Like, if you're really a smart person, how is you engaging with stupid people a good use of your time? Like, why not engage with people that have similar ideas, that are trying to build their dreams, that are trying to like get grounded in something, or trying to like refine their character and gain wisdom and be better? You know what I'm saying? Because those are the people you want to surround yourself with. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know why your mom doubts you. I don't know why your own dad is against you. I don't know why your own household is your enemy. I don't know why, but it doesn't matter why. You know what I'm saying? Because as you venture off into your journey, strangers are going to come out of nowhere and support you. And you're going to be like, well, I wonder why I can't get that type of support from my family. And then you're going to dwell on how it should be your family supporting you instead of strangers. There's two words that are destroying lives on a daily basis. Here's the two words: should and shouldn't. People are obsessed with what should be happening, and they're obsessed with what shouldn't be happening. And the more you obsess over what you think shouldn't be happening, the more you dwell on those things and you think that someone doesn't have the right for their character to be what it is. They don't have the right to be evil. They don't have the right to make mean comments. They don't have the right to doubt you. Like, who are you? Like, why don't they have the right to do whatever it is they prefer to be doing? Like, you have the right to do what you prefer to do. You know what I mean? And the more you focus on what other people don't have the right to be doing or should or shouldn't be doing, it just distracts you. You know what I'm saying? And it's going to raise your blood pressure. You know what I'm saying? Now you got high blood pressure. Now you need medication because your blood pressure is so unstable because you can't handle negative comments. And you think that the negative comments should be turned off or they should go away because your life would be convenient or better. Your life gets better when you get stronger. You know what I'm saying? When you have mental fortitude. Mental fortitude is available to every single person. Everything you struggle with, there's a book written on that subject. There's a podcast dedicated to it. There's people speaking on how to overcome those things. If you can't handle internet trolls, you know what I mean? Like a good YouTube search, Google search. How do you deal with internet trolls? Type that in. You know what I'm saying? But people are more interested in criticizing more interested in complaining about what other people are doing than they are interested in finding what's the solution. Because the more you focus on a problem, the problem magnifies itself and becomes greater. You know what I mean? But when you become solution conscious instead of problem conscious, your life changes because it's no longer about the problem. You know what I mean? If you make it about the problem, then it's always going to be problematic. And then 10 years later, the same types of comments that used to be said, that used to trigger you, 10 to 15 years later, the same types of comments trigger you. You know what I'm saying? And then you rage over it, and then you get mad, and then you go to the doctor, and the doctor tells you you're bipolar, you have anger issues. No, you have expectation issues. You expect that people don't have the right to behave the way that they want to. You know what I'm saying? Like, the only reason I have inner peace, I give everybody full permission to be whatever the hell they prefer to be. And that's none of my business. The only thing that's my business is for me to inspire as many people as I can, for me to live out my purpose, fulfill my mission before I die, and then get the hell out this earth. That's it. Like, you know what I'm saying? I don't know how much time I have left. And if I spend any time squandering it on what you are saying behind me, or what, how much you're doubting me, or what you're doing this, and you know what I'm saying, what does that have to do with me? Nothing. It's only my business for as long as I make it my business. And I choose not to make it my business because it doesn't edify me or encourage me to know the bad things. Yo, some of you, you're so curious as to what people are saying about you that, you know what I mean, when someone that you don't like hangs out with someone that you do like, the first thing you ask them, oh, so, you know, just wondering, like, did they have anything bad to say about me? Why are you even asking that question? Because as soon as you find out, yes, they had nothing but bad to say about you, you're going to go back to that other person and try to tell them that they shouldn't do that. And then 2 hours later, they're back to talking about you, saying that, man, this dude tried to tell me that I don't have the right to do this. Well, I'm going to keep doing it. Nothing that person could do about it. And what are you going to do? Kill them? Like, beat them up? Like, you know what I'm saying? And some of you want to be famous. Some of you want to be massively successful. You know what I mean? So if 1 million people are talking about you behind your back, what are you going to fight 1 million people? You're going to, like, engage with, you know what I'm saying? Like, and you might be like, well, if you're a celebrity, of course it doesn't make sense to engage with everybody. Whether you're a celebrity or not, one moment of your time being wasted on internet trolls, how is that a good use of your time, whether you're celebrity status or not? You know what I'm saying? And if your goals never become magnified above the bull crap that you'd rather not deal with, then you're always going to have time for mediocrity, to engage in the same mediocrity as these people. And you're going to be no different than them. Because if they're stupid for making stupid comments, then you're going to be stupid as well for reacting and engaging and just spending quality time with people that have nothing to do with where you want to go. You know what I'm saying? They don't even have the mindset to understand your dream. That's probably why they're doubting you. Your dream makes no sense to them. Your vision wasn't given to them. Don't you think if your vision was given to them, or if they have a similar vision, then they would understand? This is why it's better to venture off into the world with people that are like-minded, and those people build together. And sometimes the like-minded people you meet is going to be a stranger. You know what I'm saying? You live in Los Angeles, you meet somebody in fucking Kentucky who is very like-minded like you, right? And then you get on your path towards entrepreneurship, towards building your brand, towards being a rapper, towards whatever it is you want to do, man. And then here's going to be your options, right? You're going to live in California, right? You're going to meet somebody in Kentucky, and then you're going to get bitter that a stranger supports you more than your family. And you're going to think that that support should be coming from your family. But guess what? You don't get to control what direction support comes from. You know what I'm saying? And dwelling leads to complaining, and complaining leads to unhappiness. You know what I mean? You know what's the difference between happy and unhappy people? Like, their focus, what they focus on. Everybody has focus, and everybody uses their focus on something. But you know what I mean? Like, if you're focusing on negativity, you're going to get consumed by it. Happy people don't focus on the things that piss them off, or happy people don't focus on everything that they think shouldn't be happening, because if they did, they wouldn't be happy people anymore, because they would be so focus driven on everything that they consider to be a problem, and they would lose sight of what actually matters. You know what I'm saying? Don't allow it to matter more than what matters most, such as your purpose. You know what I'm saying? Having a relationship with God. You know what I mean? Like, whatever it is that you want to do for your community, whatever it is that you want to give back to other people, whatever it is that you want to become and do with your life. You know what I'm saying? Like, what's up, Matt? What's going on, bro? What's up, Ariana? So, bro, like, I'm telling you, like, I know a lot of people who sometimes I'll hang out. Oh, man. What's up, Delania? I didn't even know you was here. Sometimes I'll hang out with a person, right? I'll hang out with a person who, there's people that don't like them. Hey, what's going on, man? Good to see you. Thanks for showing up. There's people that don't like them, right? And they'll be like, yo, so what are they saying about me behind my back? Like, did they say anything bad? And I'm like, bro, if I tell you that they say something bad, you're asking a question that's going to only ignite anger into your heart. Like, are you in the mood to be angry? Because if you are, I'll tell you everything they said about you. If that's going to make your day go better, it'll just ruin your day. That's why, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you know that the crap people say is going to ruin your day to know it, why even be curious to know things that are going to destroy your whole day, like the whole mood of your day? You know what I'm saying? And it has nothing to do with your day. You know what I'm saying? Like, I thoroughly believe that what you say about me behind my back has nothing to do with me, even though it's about me. It's none of my business. And you could talk as much shit as you want when I'm not around. You know what I'm saying? And then I'll probably hear about it, and it's cool, and I'll still shake your hand as if I don't even know it's happening, because I don't care about that shit. That's why I'll shake your hand. You might be like, oh, I'll never shake the hand of a person that I know was talking badly about me. That's because you care what people think and you care what people say. That's why you wouldn't shake their hand. And what they're saying, that like the locker room conversations behind your back actually molds your perspective of these people. And now you lose sight of how much they mean to God, because they don't mean anything to you anymore because they crossed the line. And the line that's been crossed is them talking about you, because you think they have no right to do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, and this is why I give people full permission to do whatever it is they prefer. Because like I said, the two words that destroy people's life is should, this should be happening, and that shouldn't be happening. And then they stay there for 45 years and be miserable and unhappy, and they wonder why. So I'm gonna tell you why. Like, don't use the word should and shouldn't. You know what I'm saying? Like, so when it comes to people, right, here's the words that I use when it comes to, like, you know, so you might hear somebody say, yo, that man over there, he should be embracing his full potential, right? And then they'll probably get mad that the person isn't. Here's what I say. That man could be embracing his full potential if he gave a damn about his full potential. So I leave it optional. It's open. You know what I'm saying? Like, the ball is in his court. If he wants to embrace his potential, cool. If he doesn't, cool. Like, you know what I'm saying? Am I excited that he's not embracing his potential? No, but I refuse to lose sleep at night over that. What does that have to do with me? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'll pray for him. I'll wish the best for him. I'll have conversations for him. I don't think he's a piece of crap just because he lives a life less than. You know what I'm saying? There's so many people that have ridiculous potential and they live a life less than, you know what I mean? For whatever reason, I don't know if it's fear holding people back. I don't know if they just don't know what the next step is, or if they've been criticized so much, or if the world told them no so much that now they start telling themselves no. You know what? I heard this before in a video. I heard somebody was like talking to Gary Vaynerchuk, one of my favorite speakers. There was like, you know, there was like, yo, Gary, you say that you shouldn't care what people think, but what about my own opinion? Like, what if the voice inside of my head is actually me talking to myself, telling me that I can't do it? And he said, bro, that's not your voice. You think that's your voice. That voice has been indoctrinated into you. That's the exterior voices that tell you that you can't. And then you hear it so much exteriorly that now, internally, you're just repeating outside voices, and it's become your inside voice, and you think it's other people's voice. You know what I'm saying? You're thinking it's your voice, because when you hear yourself talking to you in your conscious mind, it's you saying it. But that's been programmed into you by other people. Nobody grows up thinking they can't do shit. You know how unnatural it is to think that you can't do something? You know what I'm saying? Like, kids, like babies, they don't think about that shit. You know what I mean? Like, they don't think about, man, I really want to walk right now, but I don't know if I fucking can, so I'm gonna just sit my ass down. But you think that, you know, they don't, that doesn't come to them. And you might say, yeah, well, they don't know a damn language. They don't know English. Maybe that's why those thoughts don't come to them. But it's deeper than that. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if doubt was such a natural thing, then even infants would have it, and it would prevent them from doing shits, fucking things that infants do. You know what I'm saying? Like, that toddlers do, like, such as walking, such as trying to reach something. Like, you know, kids that, like, if there's something on a high counter, they never think to themselves, man, that shit looks high, I don't know if I can't reach it. They try to reach that shit. There's nothing preventing them, because they haven't been programmed yet to tell themselves that they're incapable of doing shit. You know what I'm saying? That's the world that programs you into that. You know what I'm saying? Like, kids will just, you know, try to reach something on a high shelf. You know what I mean? And they'll get creative as shit, man. They'll prop something up and try to get on top of that to go get it if they can't, like, stand on their tippy toes to reach it. You know what I mean? They're resourceful as hell. Like, why is it that a 4-year-old is more resourceful than a 47-year-old? Because the 47-year-old has been indoctrinated by other people to believe that he can't. And now he repeats outside voices. Now that's his inside voice saying to his own subconscious mind and his conscious mind, I can't do it. Because he heard it 1,000 times from his mother, from his father, from family members, from other people. And now his belief system matches everybody else around him. You know what I mean? And the way life breaks down for me is only 2 categories. Either things are a good use of your time, or it's a complete waste of your time. So you might have some thoughts in your head that seem natural to you because you've had these thoughts for 25 years. But it's either a good use of your time thinking those thoughts, or it's a complete waste of your time. For instance, somebody might be a jerk to you, right? And then you might first think to yourself, man, I wonder why he's like that. And then you say, oh, and then it clicks. Oh, because he's an asshole. That's why he acts that way. You know what I mean? And maybe an asshole is exactly what that person is being to you, right? Maybe that's exactly what they're being. But I promise you, it doesn't serve you if you look at them that way. Because if you look at them that way, you dwell on it, complain about it. And then you complaining about their behavior destroys your day. You see what I mean? But what if instead you're like, man, these people just don't know who they are. God, man, I pray for that person. Like, I wish that person happiness. They must be going through something. For them to let out so much anger on me and I didn't even do anything to them. Like, maybe it's their wife. Maybe their kids. Maybe they're going through a divorce. Maybe someone just killed themselves in their family. Maybe, you know what I'm saying? People go through shit. And I know that some of you are going to be like, yo, I don't care what you're going through. That's no excuse for you to be an asshole towards me. I get what you're saying when you say that. But we say that because we don't give a damn what other people go through for as long as their shit starts interfering with our life. And we feel like we're being negatively impacted. And this is why the greatest thing I've ever heard in my life from a close friend, his name's Ronnie. Haven't seen this dude in so long, man. I miss talking to him. He told me, he said, bro, I believe God wants you to get to the point where nothing can impact you negatively. Nothing anymore. All you have to do, have the power to do, is to impact other people positively. Like, nothing bothers you. Nothing annoys you. Nothing, you know what I'm saying? And then there's never a barrier to my love for people. You know how you overcome people that annoy the shit out of you? You love them. I know that sounds crazy because there's some unlovely people that you just don't want to love. And they've done some questionable things that make you want to place them in a category of people that you'd rather cut off and have nothing to do with them. But I promise you, if you love people, and love is patient, love is kind, you know what I'm saying? It doesn't seek its own. It doesn't take an account of suffered wrongs. It's not bothered by the wrong things that are done to it. You know what I'm saying? Like, God doesn't wake up in a pause. He doesn't do it. He's always awake. But God is not like, yo, man, these damn people, I send my son to die for them, and the nerve of them to turn around and do this. Like, I wake them up in the morning and they don't even pray to me first. They check their Twitter feed. They check Instagram. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, all the thoughts that you rationalize and you consider normal, if God had those thoughts, this world wouldn't have hope. You know what I'm saying? Nobody would have hope, because he'd be in heaven bitter as hell. Bitter as hell that you're not doing the things that he wants you to do, that you're not becoming the person that he wants you to become, that his needs are not being met. And then God himself would seem like a basket case, and it would seem like he only created humans because he desperately needs a friend, and he has no emotional security without you doing the things that he needs you to do in order for God to be okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, that sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? God is powerful. God is strong. He's calm. He's patient. You know what I'm saying? This is how I know that we were created to have the same powers, to be calm, patient. You know what I'm saying? Nothing easily disturbs us. You know what I mean? So many people are easily disturbed and they think they have a fucking bipolar syndrome. You have an expectation issue. You know what I'm saying? When people push your hot button, you know what I mean? Like, first of all, like, all right, let me tell you about internet trolls, right? They love when they find out what your red hot buttons are, because that's the buttons that they're going to push. If you get rid of your buttons, there's nothing for other people to push anymore, because you're dead to yourself. You're dead to the old philosophies of, if you touch me here, I'm going to react that way. If you say these type of words, then you're going to get, you know, this amount of devil out of me is going to come out. You know what I'm saying? If you say this, if you say that, that's going to trigger me. It's no more of that. Because why? Because you wake up in the morning and you try to love as many people as you can, and you try to fulfill your purpose. And if someone's mean towards you, you don't take it personal, because it's not personal. You know what I'm saying? Because even if it's their energy is directed towards you, they're probably going through something, and their issue probably has nothing to do with you. They probably had a million issues before you met them. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't know what people are going through. And if you take it personal, then you'll treat them accordingly. You'll give them what they deserve, and you won't see them the way God does. You won't love them the way that God loves them. You know what I'm saying? And then you're going to, like, cut them off, and then you won't, whatever gets produced in your heart and then comes out of your mouth, it won't make them better people. It'll only make them worse. Because when you meet an asshole and you treat him for face value, you're making him worse. You know what I'm saying? But when you know how to, like, speak to his soul and his spirit, like, and when you really love this person, I promise you, man, God will take your words directly into that person's heart, because now it's coming from a place of love and concern instead of animosity and frustration. And you know what I'm saying? So many times you try to correct somebody's behavior because they piss you off. And that's the only reason you're trying to correct them. You know what I mean? Like, I see it in the elderly, like, you know, when they look at, you know, the youth, they'd be like, man, these arrogant kids, or you need to do this, or you need to do that. The only reason you're speaking to that teenager is because that person's behavior pisses you off. And you probably don't even love that teenager that you're trying to correct. You're just trying to tell them, back in my days, it was like this, and kids have respect, and you damn kids need a spanking. Maybe that'll straighten you out. Maybe you need this, and you know what I'm saying? And it's like, yo, no one's hearing that. No one hears that, because you just sound like a frustrated person that doesn't give a damn about their life. That's why your words have no impact to change that person. If you actually love the people you're trying to correct, they will change. You know what I mean? When you actually see them the way that God does. You know what I'm saying? But anyways, getting back on topic, I know that some people are not going to support your dream, and they're going to be people that you wish had supported you. They're going to be people like family, your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother, whoever. You know what I'm saying? Like, here's the thing about life. right? Life is a numbers game, right? A certain amount of people are going to support you. A certain amount of people are not. You don't get to choose who those people are, right? Like, I used to receive, like, all right, yo, when I was in school, fat chicks used to love me, man. I'm not into fat girls like that, but they used to really love me. I used to be like, yo, how come I can't get this type of love from the hot chicks that I'd rather date? You know what I'm saying? Like, why, how come I can't get those girls to like me? I have no control over that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't control who likes me. You know what I mean? Like, we like to pick and choose who we think should be the ones that support us, but that's out of our control. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me tell you things that are completely out of your control so you could not worry about these things. Other people's opinions, other people's behavior. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you could inspire them. You could try to talk to them. But if you try to just correct them because you're frustrated, your words have no authority to go into their heart because you just sound like a frustrated person. But other people's opinion, other people's actions, other people's behavior, their mindset. You know what I'm saying? Like, we try to control these things. Like it's up to us who other people are. You know what I'm saying? Which means that we wake up in the morning to get our needs met by society, to think that, you know, everybody should live up to the rules that we set in our head for what this world should look like. People should behave this way. They should say thank you. They should have gratitude. And I get what you say when you say common courtesy. Well, it's just common courtesy. If you open a door for a person, they should thank you. You know what I mean? And it's like, yo, what about having empathy for the person that didn't thank you? Because while you're thinking that your needs should be met, their mother's dying from cancer, right? And they're not in the mood to be thankful for anybody. Not you holding the door for them. Not you letting them merge into traffic. Not you giving them money to pay their bills. Because their mom has, you know, stage 5 cancer. And she's been told by her doctor that she has 2 weeks left to live. And this person can't find it in their heart to have gratitude towards anything else because they're mad at God himself. They hate God right now. And when that person that didn't say thank you because you held the door open for them, when they hate God, what makes you think they're going to have any type of gratitude towards whatever kind, quote unquote, kind gesture you just did? People want such fucking gratification of other people saying kind things to you, man. So what? You held a fucking door open for somebody. What, you want an award for that? You want a trophy? Like, you know what I'm saying? Doing the right thing is always the right thing. You know what I'm saying? If you're a good person, you're supposed to do good things if you're a good person. You know what I mean? Like, we over and over, we do kind things for people and then remind them quickly that we didn't have to do those kind things. Like, then don't do it then. You know what I'm saying? You're so bitter because your needs have not been met, because you did it with some type of expectation, whether it be a fucking thank you or some consideration. Here's what people like to say: man, the least I could get is a thank you. No, let me tell you what the least you could get is. The least you could get is fucking nothing. That's the least. You want to talk about the least? Getting nothing from a person is the least. You know what I'm saying? And when you become satisfied, when you say I'm content no matter what people give me, like if I do something for you and you don't even thank me, it's cool. When you get to that level, you will have happiness, because it's not about how other people respond to you anymore. You gave that man food because you knew you were supposed to, because it was in your heart, because you know God put it in your heart, and you're not going to get resentful towards him just because he doesn't have the audacity to thank you. You know what I'm saying? It's like, bruh, like, what are you, like, royalty? Like, you know what I'm saying? Everyone needs to thank you for you to not be a basket case. Everyone needs to be what you want them to be for you to emotionally be okay. Like, why are you an emotional liability to yourself as well as every single person around you? You know what I'm saying? And we normalize that shit. We think we were born that way. We think that that's life. You know what I'm saying? And you accept it because there's thousands of other failing ass people around you who have emotional weakness and justify it as well. And you come to the conclusion that it must be normal, because if it wasn't normal, then millions of other people wouldn't struggle with it. But what if what millions of people are doing, it's only normal because millions of people are doing it, but not because they were created to feel, think, and act that way? You know what I'm saying? What if it's only normal because we rationalize it and it becomes our norm, even though it has nothing to do with the normality that would be if God, like, you know, like if the way that God thinks was the way that we think? You know what I'm saying? If his spirit, like, dwelled in us for real, like, you know what I'm saying? If his thoughts were our thoughts, life would be different. You think God is stressed every day about the things you stress about, complaining about people, complaining about things not going his way and being bitter? And man, I do this for people, and the only time they come back to me is getting another blessing out of me, and they don't even thank me for the last blessing they got. Yo, if God thought like that, God would wake up in the morning like, yo, I don't know if I want to be God anymore, man. I'm fucking feeling discouraged today. Like, I don't know if I could do it, man. Like, he'd be a basket case. You know what I'm saying? And he's not like that. He's powerful. Why? Because he has a mentality to keep him strong. You know what I'm saying? Jesus has a mentality to keep him strong. Like, you people, you make Jesus to be a special man, but you forget what makes him special is the fact that he's love and we're not in a lot of cases. And love is patient. Love is kind. You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, man, sometimes you're driving on a road, right? And there's a slow ass driver in front of you, and you can't stand how slow they're driving. And you get pissed off to the point where you think that people like that shouldn't exist on the road or they shouldn't drive like that. The only reason you're bothered is because it's an inconvenience to you. And it's an inconvenience to you because you're saying these two words. Man, it should happen this way. And it shouldn't happen that way. This is why I say the word should and shouldn't is destroying your lives, because it leads to you dwelling and then complaining and then being unhappy. And then the fucking cycle continues for 45 years. And then you need a psychologist to get you through that shit. When if only you would get rid of your entitlement and your expectation, you actually be emotionally okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, so yeah, man, like if I'm cursing a lot, I apologize. I'm fired up right now, man. I got a lot of passion behind what I'm saying, because like I really care about people, man. And I don't want, you know, people to go through shit like emotionally that could be avoided if we remove our entitlement, or if we remove our expectation, if we stop thinking that people should be a certain way, you know what I'm saying? Instead of just saying, yo, you know what? Regardless of how evil you're acting, it's my duty to love you. You know what I'm saying? Because in loving you, I'll have inner peace. And in loving you, I get to free you from who you are. Because you're going to remember me as being the one person that actually saw the value in you. Because while you was acting evil and scaring away every other pedestrian, I was the one person that was patient with you. You know what I'm saying? And then now grace enters into their life, right? And they remember you as being that one person that didn't not necessarily enable them to continue being that way. See, we don't want to be forgiven because we think that that makes us a doormat, and we don't want to be walked all over like a floor mat. You know what I'm saying? So that's why we don't want to forgive, because we think we're enabling people to continue being messed up. You know what I'm saying? People are going to be what they're going to be. You know what I'm saying? But if you're enabling them for being kind and forgiving, then that means there's at least one sin, all of you, that you've committed this one sin at least 1,000 to 2,000 times or more. And every time God forgive you for that sin, if he forgave you for it 2,000 times, then I guess he's enabling you, right? I guess God's a sucker for enabling you to continue being wicked. You know what I mean? Man, he should have brought judgment. He should have did this. Like, man, you know what I'm saying? Like, there's, and then can you imagine there's people in heaven speaking into God's ear, like, yo, man, why are you forgiving these people? Don't you see what they do to you? Don't you see how they mistreat you? They don't thank you. They have no gratitude. You still want to wake these people up in the morning? Man, you should rain judgment and hellfire upon their ass, like, right now. Like, you know what I'm saying? There's so many people who you should shove a lightning bolt up their ass right now, because they have no gratitude and that's what they deserve. And then people get what they deserve constantly. That's what the world would look like, man. Like, you know what I mean? Thank God that whenever we do something wrong, there's grace. Because if you got what you deserve every time you deserved it, life would be a lot worse than what it is, or whatever you consider it to be. You know what I'm saying? Like, thank God for grace. You know what I'm saying? Thank God for mercy. You know what I'm saying? And it's not because he's an enabler. It's not because he's enabling you to continue being wicked. It's because he knows what he created you for. He knows how amazing your life would look like if only you gave a damn about your purpose, your potential. You know what I'm saying? Like he's holding on to the image of what could be. Like, you know, love covers a multitude of sin. You know what I mean? Like, you know why a woman could get her ass beat by a guy for 6 years and still be with him? Because even though he seems monstrous, she doesn't see him as being a monster. Because if she did, she would have left. She sees him for his potential. She sees him for what he could be if he wasn't so abusive, physically abusive. She doesn't see the monstrous side. And then even though society can't understand that shit, and they're like, yo, I would have left, or I would have did this. How could you? Man, at some point, you got to love yourself, man. You got to love yourself. That's what people say, right? You got to love yourself enough to not tolerate this type of behavior. You know what I mean? But she really loves the person, and she knows that he's not meant to be that way. And she knows that if he ever snaps out of it, he'll walk into his potential. And that's what she loves. She's not in love with the monstrous side, and she doesn't even see him as being that. She's in love with his potential and what he could be if he cared about his potential. That's why a woman holds on to a guy who's abusive as hell, because she doesn't see him as an abuser. She sees him as an amazing person. You know what I mean? Like, so yeah, man. Anyways, give me a second. Let me see how much time I got. I'm at 10%. All right, when my phone gets to 5%, I gotta go, you guys. So yeah, man, you know, I know that it sucks, you know, when family doesn't support brothers, sisters, but I need you to not get consumed by that, because there's something something amazing you're supposed to do in this world. I have no idea what it is. You're going to have to take that one up with God, have a conversation with him. He'll reveal it to you. I just don't want you getting consumed and other people's petty behaviors and emotions, feelings, ideas, and thoughts. None of that has nothing to do with where you're going. It's going to keep you stationary. It's going to keep you being an unaccomplished person, complaining, whining about everything that's not going your way. You know what I'm saying? It's going to keep you, and then you're going to get discouraged. Then you're going to dwell. Then you're going to get into depression. Then you're going to, in order for you to get discouraged, who does your focus have to be on? It has to be on yourself first. It's impossible to get discouraged unless your focus is on yourself. But when your focus is on, you know what I'm saying? Let me love as many people as I can. God, help me to see people the way that you see them. And when your focus is on, man, like, how can I get successful? How can I, like, accomplish my mission? When your focus is on bigger things, then all you see is the things that you focus on. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you focus on what annoys you, you train your mind to see that. And then that becomes all that you see, because that's all that you're looking for. You know what I'm saying? So, like I said, happy people, unhappy people, they both know how to focus, but they both focus on two different things. You know what I'm saying? Like, half cup full, half cup empty. It's crazy how the same measure could mean two different things to two different people from two different perspectives. Like, why would someone even have an argument as to whether a cup is half empty or half full? You know what I'm saying? If it's half empty, then to that person, they only see the cup for what it doesn't have. They can't have gratitude towards the half a cup that they do have, because they're mad that it's not full as, quote unquote, it should be. You know what I mean? They're probably using the word should. That's why they're miserable. You know what I mean? But to the person that, you know, thinks that it's, you know, well, you know, it's half full. Or, and then there's a third type of person. It's like, man, at least I got something in my cup. Shit, man. Half full, half empty. None of that shit matters. I have something in my cup. Other people have a dry ass cup. I have something. You know what I mean? Like, there's points of gratitude. There's things that you could be grateful for. You know what I'm saying? Like, the complaining only stops when a gratitude begins. And if you complain constantly, it gets in the way of your gratitude. If you don't have gratitude, you won't have happiness. You know what I mean? So the way to have gratitude is to focus on the things that you're excited about in life. I promise you, if you focus hard enough, you'll find these things. And if you learn how to delete and filter things, because sometimes you think you're never going to forget somebody's behavior, but you're not never going to forget it for as long as you keep telling yourself that. You're like, I'm never going to forget how you cheated on me, how you played me, how you said these specific words. But how many times have you forgot your full address or your phone number or how to spell the word the? So you can forget things, and forgetting things is actually a useful tactic. You know what I'm saying? Especially when you're only forgetting your perception of what you thought things was, because sometimes your perception makes you twist other people's words and make them say things that they didn't even say. But because you're looking to be offended, you're always offended, because that's what you look for in every text message that you read and every message that you listen to and every video that you watch. You know, people that look to criticize, they only see things for what they could criticize. That's why I have a lot of poor minded friends and I love them to death, but if I send them a video about wealth generation or about, like, you know, financial wisdom, they'll only see these videos for what they could criticize, because they're going to see the information in the video, judge it according to their life or where they're not, and then get condemned by a video that's calling them to a greater purpose financially. You know what I'm saying? Like, because they can't see past what they could criticize. You know what I'm saying? People who listen to criticize, they look like this. Tell me, have you ever had a conversation with a person who you get 7 seconds into speaking, you know, maybe 9 or 10 seconds if you're lucky, before they have a rebuttal? They always have a rebuttal to everything you're saying. It's like they listen long enough to have a rebuttal, which means they're not listening. I know a person who does this all the time. You know what he told me? Because I asked him about that. I'm like, bro, why you always do that shit? You know, like, is your attention span, is it not worth more than 10 seconds? Like, that, you know what I'm saying? After 10 seconds, you have to rebuttal. And then he said, well, you know, if you talk for 5 minutes and then you say this mistake and then you say this and then you say this, it's like, then I have to get a notepad and I have to respond to all the things you said that didn't make sense. And it's better to just cut you off before we continue the conversation before. And it's like, nah, bro, like, you don't listen to have a conversation. You listen to rebuttal me to death. There's a difference, you know what I'm saying? Because if you was listening to understand me, you wouldn't feel like you fucking need a notepad to hear every segment and then have a direct response to that. And it's like, bro, are you trying to understand me? Or are you trying to, like, get me to look at the other side of everything? There's people that are so insecure with their ideas that they need to pull other people into their side of the fence with their ideas. Here's how awesome my idea is that I'm going to force you to believe in it and then condemn you if you don't. That doesn't sound like a good philosophy, you know what I'm saying? Because if it's a good philosophy, then it'll speak for itself when you present it to people. If it's reasonable, they'll take it. And if they don't, that's not your business, you know what I'm saying? Like, at least you presented it. At least if you had something that was worth saying, you said it. And maybe that seed will take root a year later. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, we try to plant seeds in people's brain. We try to water it, and then we try to force the damn plant to come out the ground. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, bro, like, the seed will take root when it's supposed to. They'll hear what they're supposed to. You know what I'm saying? Like, they'll change when they're supposed to, you know? So I don't know, man. There's so many things that I trust God with. That's why I don't have anxiety. That's why I don't have all these damn disorders. Because in the areas, give me a second. Oh, I appreciate that. Thank you, man. You might live your life in a way that's like dangerous or whatever, but I trust God with your life. I don't trust you with your own life. I trust God with it. You know what I'm saying? Because of that, no matter how reckless your decisions are, you know what I'm saying? I'm not losing sleep at night over what you're doing. I refuse to have fear. You know what I'm saying? Perfect love casts out all fear. That's actually a scripture. You know what I'm saying? So when my love for you becomes perfect, then you can't worry me to death. We think other people worrying us to death is normal, and we call that concern. No, you're being an emotional basket case is what you're being. Like, that's not normal. If you normalize that, then every time your kids do like crazy ass stuff and you have a heart attack every time, like, your time in this world is going to be very limited. You know what I'm saying? And then you might meet an early fate, and then people at the funeral blame your kids for giving you a heart attack. When really, if you would have learned how to manage your emotions and actually trust the Lord, like, people wouldn't give you heart attacks if you just trusted God with the things that make no sense to you, or trusted God with the things that you feel like you should have control over. You know what I'm saying? So what's up, Timothy? What's going on, bro? So yeah, man, I've just stopped believing that I need to have control over everything. And that's really why, you know, that I have inner peace. And I just thank God for that. You know, like, I used to think that people should text me back sooner. They should love me. They should do this. They should consider me. And it's like, yo, they should do what they want. You know what I mean? Cause that's what they're going to do. You know what I mean? Well, excuse me. Like, I mean, I would prefer, of course, that they do what God has set out for them. But so many people walk away from their purpose. And if I spend all my time getting sad about that, then I'll dwell, and then I won't fulfill minds. You know what I mean? And if I don't fulfill minds, I have no idea how many people suffer because I won't meet my potential, because I'm getting overcome by the world. You know what I'm saying? Like, Jeff Bezos, give me a second. Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon, the CEO, because he cared about his potential, he directly impacted 6,000 people that are now employed under him. You know what I'm saying? Like, and so many other people that are drop shipping on Amazon and selling items. And so many people, Amazon is their online business. That's what they do. You know what I mean? So because this man cared about fulfilling his potential, you know why he's so damn rich? Because he brought so much value to the marketplace. You think rich people are lucky? It's another topic I want to cover really quickly. Rich people are not lucky. You know what I'm saying? They succeed on purpose, not by accident. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't just so happen if someone fucking succeeds. Like, they took action. They did a lot of hard work. It took a while. You know what I'm saying? Like, Amazon was in a process. He was making that for like a while before. You know what I mean? So yeah, man. So I bring him up as an example because 6,000 people, that's a lot of damn people that are directly employed under him because he cared enough about his potential to fulfill it. You know what I'm saying? And he actually was working on something that brought a tremendous amount of value to the marketplace. And that's why he's one of the richest men on in the world, because the value that he brings. You know what I mean? So in terms of wealth, I know a lot of people want to be rich, but they're like, man, if only I could bring $1 million. If you start thinking, if only I could serve 1 million people, you'll have $1 million, because in servitude, there's so much gain from that. You know what I mean? You have to be of service to get paid. I mean, like, you think your job would pay you if you was of no service to them? Like, you know what I mean? So I know some people get mad to get paid $7 an hour, $8 an hour. They're like, man, why that is? Why is that? Because to the marketplace, that's how much you're worth. You know, I know you're not worth that much to you're worth way much more to your mother, to your father, to God himself. You're worth more than $8 an hour. But to the marketplace, whatever job you're doing is worth that amount. You know what I'm saying? And becoming more valuable in the same amount of time is the only way to make twice as much money, three times as much money, four times as much money. Like, you know, you got to do a lot of niche researching and find out what is it that you're talented at, and find a way to bring tremendous value in that area that you're incredibly talented at, right? And then you'll see your net worth double and triple and quadruple. You know what I'm saying? This is how people get rich, by bringing value to the marketplace. Money is a value exchange. Your job would not pay you if you wasn't doing something. So they're paying you for your time. You know what I mean? But the rich people, they're getting paid for the value, whatever value that they bring. You know what I mean? Like if Oprah does an interview right now, she's not doing that shit for free because her, you know, she's bringing a lot of value to the other person for just showing up to their podcast. So I have no idea how much, what her price is or what she would charge, but it'd probably take a lot of money. You know what I'm saying? Unless Oprah really liked the person that, and that's the power. One other thing, right? That's the power of being a likable person, right? Because someone like Oprah, can you imagine? She likes you so much that she doesn't charge you to do an interview. She's like, yo, man, I really like you, so I'll do it for free. Yo, shit like that happens when people like you. So for those of you saying, man, I don't care if anyone doesn't like me, bruh, like when nobody likes you, stuff like that won't happen for you. No one wants to do stuff for you for free. They're gonna charge you. You know what I'm saying? Like I had a situation where somebody underpaid me, they undercut me, right? And then they wanted more out of me after that. You know what I'm saying? They got a song out of me, and then they wanted a music video after me after that. Do you know if I really like this person's character, if it was like nothing but positive energy, like I would have did it, man. I probably did do the video for free, but because I didn't like this person because of what happened, I was like, yeah, I don't know, dude. Like I don't know about all that. I was just kind of like to myself. I was like, yeah, like maybe if you pay me $200, I'll be in your music video, or you pay me, like, you know what I'm saying? Like now it's like, yo, you gotta pay me because I don't like you. That's why I'm charging you. You know what I mean? So, yo, there's power in people liking you, man. They'll do shit for free if they like you. You know what I mean? But with entitlement, sometimes we meet people and we think that they should just do it for free, or they should do it at a ridiculously low cost just because you're my boy, or just because whatever reason. And it's like, you know what I mean? So I would never ask somebody to do a job without trying to pay them something, you know what I'm saying? And asking them, yo, I got this amount, is that cool? So yeah, man. Anyways, I don't know if I got much more to say for this podcast. You know what I mean? I hope I brought value to you guys. And yeah, I just want to say it's okay if you don't get support, emotional support. That's not what you need. What you need is to believe in yourself, regardless of how many people are disbelievers. That's what you need. And for your belief to be so damn strong that you're willing to believe it alone by yourself, that's when your belief is powerful. Your belief is not powerful as if everybody's like sustaining it with their emotional support of it. That's not a powerful belief system. It's powerful because you have a support system. But as soon as your support system collapses, your belief system collapses with it because it was rooted in other people supporting you and not rooted in, damn it, if other people support me, because I support me, and that's enough, and that's sufficient, and I'm gonna do it regardless who says what. You know what I'm saying? That's powerful. Nobody can stop you when you think like that. Because when you need your mommy and daddy to say nice things to you, then for as long as they're saying those nice things to you, you feel encouraged to go live out your dreams. But if they're not, and if your friends are not, and if nobody's joining in and emotionally supporting you, then you're a mess, then you're bitter, then you're complaining, and you're vlogging about it, and you're doing videos, and you know what I'm saying? And your long posts, like, man, why do people act this way? And you're getting consumed by the world, you know what I'm saying? And consumed by other people's behavior that you don't even have the authority to change until you actually love them, you know, love them more than you complain about them, you know, love them more than they irritate you know? So, because the people you're irritated by, you won't be able to change them. Because every time you speak to them, you're going to speak to them in irritation, right? And that becomes the emotion that you transfer to them. Energy is always being transferred. You know what I'm saying? So when you're irritated with a person and then you start speaking, that energy of you being irritated is getting inside of them. Now they might lash at you and say some questionable things that you wish they didn't say. And you might question, man, why is their energy so weird? It's because your energy is weird. You transmitted that to them. Now they feel like they have to reciprocate it back to you. But the same thing with kindness, the same thing with love, the same thing with, you know what I'm saying? Like the same thing with bringing value. You know what I mean? Like, man, there's so many people. There's some people that Gary Vaynerchuk has brought so much value that they're like, yo, I'll give you $100,000 for 1 hour of your time right now. Like he usually gets paid. Like he actually got sent that money and he had to send it back. He was like, dude, I can't do it. But people love him that much that they're like, yo, let me get 1 hour of your time. I just want to talk about business. You know what I'm saying? I'll send you 100 grand. He usually gets paid at a speaking engagement, $100,000, to go speak to like 7,000 people or whatever. You know what I'm saying? That's like a speaking engagement fee. And he got a single person paying that to him. Why? It's the love. You know what I'm saying? Like when people love you, man, that shit could be like monetized. You know what I'm saying? Now that you have a brand, now that you sell hoodies, now that you have t-shirts, people buy into your brand because they like you. You know what I'm saying? Like, and then you profit off of that. You know what I'm saying? Like, so yeah, there's so many people are like, yo, buy my shit, buy my album, buy this, buy that. You know what I'm saying? And you think because people known you for 10 years that they should buy it. But it's like, yo, they probably don't like your music. Maybe they don't like your brand. Maybe they think your t-shirts are corny. So if people don't like the brand, or if people don't like, you know, the person behind the brand, then they might not buy that t-shirt. They might not support the podcast. They might not. People have to like it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I knew somebody who was trying to get me to like their YouTube channel, and they were kind of like, yo, what do I have to do for you to like my stuff? And I'm like, there's probably nothing you could do. I might always think that your videos are garbage, but don't get discouraged by that, because you don't need me to like your videos. I need you to like doing those videos and just keep doing them regardless of who likes it, and make the marketplace come to you, because somebody's going to like that shit. Like, I hate Minecraft. That's okay. It wasn't created for me to like it. Other people in this world love that game. You know what I'm saying? Like, that game made like 145 million sales. That's crazy. You know, which that proves to me, like, who gives a damn if I don't like Minecraft? Like, the marketplace has spoken, and that's a popular game. You know what I'm saying? Like, looking at that game, it looks like a $50,000 game, $100,000 game max. Who would have known that it's worth 148 million sales and at least $1.5 billion? You know what I'm saying? Like, who would have known? Like, I wouldn't have known, but... And that's the thing, right? You might be sitting on something that other people... They might marginalize as, man, this is only a $50,000 idea, $100,000 idea. And you might be sitting on something worth $1.5 billion and you won't do it because your fucking mom doesn't support you. Like, go do that shit. You know what I'm saying? That's why I need you to believe in you, regardless of who disbelieves. It doesn't matter. You know what I'm saying? If you let that consume you, then it's not about your dream. You know what I mean? People be like, yo, I got a huge dream. I'm going to do this. And they start announcing their whole damn life and what's going to happen. And the more announcements you make, the more people question how realistic your announcements are. The more people doubt you. When you don't make announcements, there's nothing for people to doubt. When people don't know your dreams, they can't shoot them down. You know what I'm saying? Like, they can't shoot them down anymore. They don't know what they are. You know what I'm saying? So when you succeed, right, and you was quiet about it, and you just let your results do the speaking, what can they say now? You know what I'm saying? Like, they didn't even know. And then they'll come up to you like, oh, how come you ain't telling me you was working on this? And it's like, dang, well, I would have. But you seem so pessimistic towards... I hear when you talk to other people about their dreams, you don't seem to support anybody. So I just kept it to myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, so anyways, yeah, man. So don't take it so personal when they don't care about your dream. You know what I'm saying? Like, life is a numbers game. And a percentage of people are just not going to give a damn what you have planned. And sometimes your family, friends, and people you love fall within those percentage of people that don't give a damn. And you can't change the percentages, the statistics, and who should be doing what. And please don't use the word should and shouldn't. It's going to ruin your life if you focus on, man, well, these people should be supporting me. And these people shouldn't be doing that, or this should be happening. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so don't wish life was easier. Wish you were stronger. Because when you get stronger, life does get easier. You know what I'm saying? Like... When you set sail, wish for the power, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, the skills and the know-how to navigate the seas, instead of wishing that the seas were calm, that there weren't storms, that you didn't have to navigate through such harsh conditions. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you're in the middle of the ocean, like, it is going to be harsh, but pray for the skills to be able to navigate. You know what I'm saying? The skills to, like, avoid your ship being shipwrecked or your boat sinking. You know what I'm saying? Don't let this world sink your boat, man. Like, because it's trying its best, and it's going to if you let it. If you let these thoughts get into your head and dictate your value and your worth, you know what I'm saying? And you start thinking that you have no worth just because nobody else sees it. You have worth if nobody sees it. You know why? Because God himself sees it. Because if he didn't, he wouldn't have sent his son to die for the world. You know what I'm saying? For those of you that believe in Jesus, man, like, that one thing alone should kill all insecurity that you have. You're like, damn, God thinks something of me. And let that be enough. Because if it's not, then you're going to make it so that people's opinion matters more than what God thinks of you. You know what I'm saying? When he's probably the only person that knows your full potential and what's really possible for your life. So, yeah, man, don't let what doesn't matter at all matter more if it doesn't matter most. You know what I mean? So with that being said, I'm out. Really love you guys, and see you on the next one. Take care.